Today we're going to talk about the family of Sri Krishna. We're going to talk about how many children he had and how many wives he had. So there is a lot of online discussion on this, and there's lots of numbers floating around about how many wives he had. So I wanted to go to the source and find out myself as to what the truth was. So I have a copy of Bhagwat Puran here. This is the English version. I have both volumes. And I looked into the actual facts about what it says in the Bhagwat Puran and the details in there. So I'm going to play the audio reading of what the Bhagwat Puran says at the end of the video. And for now, I'm just going to summarize what I discovered so you can skip the audio reading at the end if you like. Basically, in the Bhagwat Puran, there is a Leela, a short story about Narad Muni visiting Sri Krishna. He himself was wondering how Bhagwan is actually dealing with all his wives. So it is said that he has 16,108 wives. How can this be even possible if you think about it? There is roughly 80,000 plus seconds in a day. And if he had 16,108 wives, then he's probably got about 5 seconds a day to spend with each of them. And that's on the assumption that he doesn't even sleep. So it seems kind of really strange that such figures were out there about Sri Krishna. So anyway, Narad Muni was wondering about how Bhagwan himself is dealing with such a high number of wives. So starting with 16,108, what he found astonishing was when he visited, he went from mansion to mansion, and then he started looking in each of them, and he found that there was Krishna in each of them. So Bhagwan was there in each mansion with a different wife, and every wife had a different mansion. So every room where he went to see and check, he was astonished to see that Bhagwan was doing different things in each of the mansions. So he was with one wife, he was, you know, playing with the children. Another wife, he goes and he sees that Bhagwan is actually doing Gayatri Mantra. And in another room where he enters, he's doing sadhana and so on. So Narad Muni was totally surprised to see all of this. Online, I haven't seen anyone actually mention this information. So I wanted to do a video and confirm this, that, you know, Bhagwan Krishna is, he manifested himself into 16,108 different forms, and he lived with each wife in each of those different forms. This is really important, you know, for people to know, because a lot of people have a negative image about, you know, putting out these type of numbers out there and making fun of the Bhagwan himself, you know, saying that he had 16,108 wives. So why can't we have four or whatever, right? So people are trying to justify these type of things. But Bhagwan did not have 16,108 wives. He manifested himself into 16,108 forms to live with each of his wives as a husband and wife, which is totally different than having, you know, multiple wives. So this was one of Bhagwan's Leela. If you look into the scriptures, you can really find good details and explanations about what actually is the actual truth, compared to what you may see online. So I wanted to do this quick video to encourage people not to just take some negative remark that's made by people about anything about Hinduism without having to check the source material on your own, and then you'll be astonished to find out what you may find in the actual scriptures compared to what people may tell you. So please visit dharmyog.com, and I have posted an article on this, And I've also posted information about the children of Bhagwan himself. So, again, this is another interesting thing that Bhagwan had, from each wives, he had 10 sons. And now the strange part is he didn't have any daughters other than with Mata Rukmani, according to Bhagavad Puran. So I have put that reference in there. And again, so 16,108 wives, and he had 10 sons from each of them, and he had one daughter with Mata Rukmani. Now, the thing is, this may not be entirely true, so I actually, again, went further, as I found it strange that there's only a mention of one daughter. It doesn't necessarily say that that's the total number of children he had. It just says that he had 10 sons from each wives, and there is just a brief note about his one daughter in the Bhagavad Puran. That doesn't mean that he didn't have other daughters. So I went a little bit further, and I found the reference in the Harivansh Puran. And in there is a mention of Satyabhama and some of the other wives. So Mata Satyabhama had four daughters, and there's also a few others. So if I continue to learn any more information on this topic, I will post that on my website on this article, so you can see any updates that I may find on this topic in terms of how many children and daughters he may have had that's mentioned in other sources other than the two that I'm actually mentioning in this video. And again, I want to encourage people to actually look at the source material from our authentic scriptures instead of going on and listening to the words of people or online chatter that may be going on, that may be taking, misusing the information, trying to defame Hinduism. So I highly recommend whatever you may learn from this video and found it useful, like, really, please make an effort to let other people know, because it's important that authentic information is shared and people don't make fun of Hinduism and things like that, which I'm really against, and is the main reason why I actually decided to go online and make these videos. Okay, so please do share and subscribe. Once again, thank you. Dhanyawad. Jai Shri Krishna.
Srimad Bhagavat Puran, Book 10, Chapter 69, A Glimpse into the Household Life of Sri Krishna. Sri Sukha began again, having heard that the demon Narakasura had been killed, and that Sri Krishna had singly married numerous girls. The sage Narad felt eager to see how the Lord lived with them all. He said to himself, "Oh, how wonderful it was that the one Lord should with one personality marry 16,000 wives in separate houses all at once." Thus full of curiosity and eager to see this sport of the Lord with his own eyes, the divine sage came to Dwarika, which was adorned with parks and gardens in full blossom and resounded with the warbling of birds and the humming of bees. It was rendered noisy with the loud crackle of swans and cranes residing in ponds spread over with full-blown lotuses and lilies of various colors. It was studded with nine lakhs of mansions built of crystal and silver, inlaid with shining emeralds and furnished with articles of gold and precious stones. It looked charming with its well-defined roads and other thoroughfares, quadrangles and marketplaces, sheds for animals, temples and guild halls. Its roads, courtyards, lanes and thresholds of houses were daily sprinkled with water. The ever-flying flags and pennons warded off sunshine. In that city there was the most splendid, richly furnished row of palaces of Lord Sri Krishna, admired by all the guardians of the world, in the construction of which Vishvakarma, the celestial architect, had exhibited all his architectural skill. The row was adorned with 16,000 beautiful mansions of Sri Krishna's consorts. Narad, at random, entered a big palace out of these. Supported on columns of coral, on excellent slabs of Vaidurya, the cat's eye gem, and walls of sapphire, it was provided with a floor whose luster never faded, paved with the same precious stone. It was, further, furnished with canopies made by Vishvakarma himself, from which strings of pearls were hanging, as well as with seats and beds made of ivory and inlaid with excellent gems. It was attended by maidservants adorned with gold necklaces and dressed in fine clothes, and manservants wearing coats, turbans, fine clothes, and jeweled earrings. Dear Pariksit, the darkness in the palace was dispelled by luster of jewels serving as lights. Seeing fumes of burning aloe wood issuing out of the air holes, the peacocks on its picturesque eaves screamed and danced under the impression that clouds were up. Narad saw Sri Krishna, the lord of Yadus, seated there together with the mistress of the house, Rukmini, who was, herself, fanning the lord with a chaur provided with a gold handle, although she was constantly waited upon by thousands of maidservants, who were equal to her in virtue, beauty, age and neat dress. Discerning the Dev Rishi, the almighty lord, Sri Krishna, the foremost among the supporters of virtue, immediately rose from the bed of Sri Rukmini, and bowing low with his head, adorned with a crown, at the feet of the sage with joined palms, installed him on his own seat. Pariksit, Sri Krishna is the supreme teacher of the world. Having washed his feet, the Ganga has become capable of purifying all. The protector of holy men, he has earned the appropriate title of Brahmanya Deva by virtue of his singular devotion to the Brahmanas. The Lord, therefore, washed the feet of the Dev Rishi and bore that water on his head. Thereafter, the Lord, who was no other than the most ancient sage Narayan, the eternal companion of Nara, duly worshipped the celestial sage according to the prescribed rules of worship, and addressing him in measured words sweet as nectar, humbly said, "Pray, tell me, my lord, what service we may render your holy self." Narad replied, "O almighty lord of the universe, it is no wonder that you love all your devotees and chastise the wicked. O glorious lord, you have come down to earth of your own accord for the supreme welfare of all, as well as for the sake of maintaining and protecting the world. We know this full well. What a great fortune that I have been enabled today to enjoy the sight of your blessed feet, which bring to mankind supreme peace and deliverance, which are ever contemplated at heart by Brahma and others possessed of infinite wisdom, the feet which are, as a matter of fact, like a rope with the help of which men fallen in the deep well of worldly life may rise above it. Kindly bless me that, wherever I may be, their thought may ever haunt me and I may go about contemplating on them." Dear Pariksit, then in order to ascertain the power of Yog Maya, divine glory of the Lord of all masters of Yoga, Narad entered the mansion of another consort of Sri Krishna. There he saw Sri Krishna, engaged in playing at dice with his beloved consort and Uddhav. There also the Lord stood up at the sight of the sage, offered him a seat, and worshipped him with supreme devotion. Then, like one who was unaware of the sage's arrival, he said, "When did you come? You are established in the self and perfect, whereas we are imperfect beings. What service can we render to you? All the same, O sage, be pleased to command us and bless our human birth." Narad, however, was astonished when he heard this, and silently rising from his seat, moved to another mansion. There too he saw Sri Krishna fondling his infant sons. Again, in another house he found the Lord preparing for his bath. In this way the Dev Rishi found the Lord engaged in different activities, all at once, in all the different mansions. If here he was engaged in pouring oblations in the sacrificial fire, there he was propitiating God through the fivefold daily sacrifices, some. Where he was feeding the Brahmanas, while elsewhere he was partaking of the remaining food, himself. Here he was performing Sandhya, and there the silent Jap of Gayatri. Here the elder brother of Gada was performing various tricks of fence with the sword and shield, and there he was riding on horses, elephants and chariots. Here he was resting on his bed, and was being eulogized by bards. In one mansion, he was conferring with Uddhav and other counselors, and in another sporting in water surrounded by courtesans. At one place he was gifting well-adorned cows to Brahmanas and listening to the recitation of auspicious Itihasas and Puranas. In one mansion he was making merry and indulging in light talk with his beloved consort, and in another he was found engaged in the careful observance of Dharma. At a third place Narad found him engaged in devising ways and means of accumulating wealth, and at another in enjoying the pleasures of sense permitted for a householder. At one place, the Dev Rishi saw him seated all by himself contemplating on the Supreme Person beyond Prakriti, and at another doing service to the elders by offering them the desired objects of enjoyment and worship. At one place, he found Sri Krishna preparing for war against some enemies, and at another discussing terms of peace. Here the Dev Rishi saw him devising with Balram the ways and means of ensuring the well-being of the virtuous, and they're performing with grandeur the wedding with due ceremony of sons and daughters with brides and bridegrooms worthy of them. Here he found him conducting festivities on a large scale, while sending off a married girl to her husband, and receiving another on return from her husband's house. People wondered to see these grand festal activities of Bhagwan Sri Krishna, the Lord of Masters of Yoga. Somewhere he saw him offering worship to the various gods, his own rays, by means of grand sacrifices, and elsewhere observing piety through the construction of wells, gardens and temples, etc., for public good. Here he found him riding on a horse born in the Indus Valley, followed by prominent Yadavs, in pursuit of game and killing animals fit for sacrifice in the course of such chase. At one place he saw Sri Krishna, the master of yoga, moving incognito among the people as well as in the mansions of the palace, etc., for ascertaining the inward feelings of their inmates as well as of the people. Having witnessed the display of wonderful powers of yoga by Sri Krishna, though following the ways of a human being, Narad spoke to him as though laughing heartily. O master of yoga, we know the secret of your wonderful powers of yoga, which cannot be easily seen even by wielders of Maya, like Brahma, and which have been revealed to our mind through the worship of your lotus feet. Pray, give me leave, O Lord, to go, so that I may move about the 14 worlds flooded with your glory, singing loudly the story of your pastimes, which is capable of purifying the whole world. The Lord replied, O sage, I am not only the teacher of Dharma, but I practice it myself, and lend countenance to those who practice it. I follow the path of Dharma in order to teach the world by my example. Therefore, do not get perplexed, my son, at the sight of this my yogic maya. Sri Sukha went on, thus, they say, the Dev Rishi saw one and the same Sri Krishna, present in all the mansions of his consorts, performing the pious duties of householders which lead to their purification. Seeing again and again, the vast display of the wonderful yogic power of Sri Krishna, who had infinite prowess, the curious sage was filled with astonishment. Duly honored by Sri Krishna, who behaved as though he made much of the first three objects of human pursuit, viz. Dharma, virtue, artha, wealth and kama, enjoyment of life, the Dev Rishi felt much delighted and went away constantly thinking of him alone. For the good of the world, O dear one, Lord Narayan takes the help of his inconceivable yogmaya and begins to sport as a human being. Greeted with their bashful looks and friendly smiles by more than 16,000 noble wives, the Lord thus delightfully spent his days at Dwarika. O Pariksit! He who for his part celebrates the inimitable exploits performed by Sri Krishna, who is the supreme cause of the evolution, continuance and dissolution of the universe, or heave of them, or views with approbation their singing and hearing, attains loving devotion to the Almighty Lord, the bestower of liberation. Thus ends the 69th discourse entitled, A Glimpse into the Household Life of Sri Krishna, in the latter half of Book 10 of the Great and Glorious Bhagavath Puran, otherwise known as the Paramahamsa Samhita.